And we are live. Welcome to Worldview Everlasting, your favorite YouTube addiction. We are here with special guest Reverend Dr. Lawrence Rast from Concordia Theological Seminary, Fort Wayne. I actually got all of that out. Excellent. And Pastor Fisk, our host. I am Peter Slayton, the Edit Monkey, Executive Director, Producer, whatnot of Worldview Everlasting. We're glad you guys could join us this evening. We will have Pastor Wolf Mueller joining us in a few minutes. He's having some technical difficulties, but Pastor Fisk, take it away.
Yeah, so Brian, as always, here with us in spirit but not in body, right? Hopefully be showing up. So, hey, it's good to have everybody with you. It's been a little more than a month, almost 2 months, I think, since our last one. We wanted to have these every single month, but Lent has been what Lent is and whatnot. But we are really privileged tonight to have someone that kind of, I think, shows us to have really hit the level of reality where we have viable guests. This is no longer just local pastors like Sam Schulteis. This is a true bureaucrat in the world of theology. Dr. Rast is well known for his study of American Lutheran history and awareness of particularly the movement of Pietism in it, and so we hope to be relying on some of his insights there as well. You might remember, if you were a longtime viewer of the show, we interviewed him as well during a Fort Wayne symposium series. Way back, that's like 3 years ago now, I think. So, Dr. Rast did just get reaffirmed, I think, by the board of directors of Fort Wayne for another 3 year, 10 year. Is that how that works? 5 years, which is a good thing, I imagine. I don't know how much stress that puts you under as a career person, and whether you have to kind of go find a job suddenly or not. But you're in for now. And those of you who talk to me regularly, you know that I think Fort Wayne, if you're going to go to seminary in the Missouri Synod, there's not even a question right now which seminary you go to. From my opinion, Fort Wayne is the place that forms the whole pastor. You don't just get the theology, although you definitely get that too, but it's not just a mind game. They care about forming you as a pastor in the parish, someone who understands what parish life is like, the cross in the parish, as well as then the liturgical formation that is intentional, which I wish my alma mater would get on the bandwagon with that, but they're just not right now, and this is kind of the way it is. And you don't have to say anything about that, Dr. Rast. You can even disagree if you like, but it's not true if you... And we'll jump toward the show proper. Yeah?
I think I'll just sit here and smile a little.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. So the first big question, and I really wish Brian was here because this is his bailiwick in so many ways, but he'll be able to jump in when he gets here. We have two questions that both are very similar to each other, they're getting at the issue of mysticism. We'll come back to that. But how does mysticism then involve the Christian's prayer life? So I'm going to read both these questions, and then I'll give a little bit of an answer, but I'm going to throw it right to you, Dr. Rast, after that. So the first question is, from a viewer who writes, "We are studying understanding the will of God in our lives. A point made during the lesson was that we can go to God in prayer and seek His will. I stated that we only receive direct revelation through His word and not in our prayers, as some charismatics claim. My pastor said that we don't receive revelation, but maybe of peace in making decisions." And then in parentheses with a question mark, "mystical? However, if we only receive guidance from scriptures and not prayer, then what's the point of praying for guidance?" And then the second question, different viewer. "Our pastor likes to preach that Jesus wants an intimate relationship with us. I know this statement has been expounded in evangelical circles, and I don't know what to think about it. To be sure, Jesus calls us friends and His brothers. However, I am not sure what kind of baggage this phrase may contain. Would you explain how we should interpret this statement from a confessional Lutheran standpoint?" Great. And I think that baggage is kind of key here, because mysticism as baggage is pretty heavy baggage. And we can't really exist in this American evangelical context and believe that we're not influenced by it, that the language that we use in religion is not being impacted by the definitions and the terms that they use. And so a term like relationship with Jesus, if it was by itself, there really wouldn't be a problem with it. But when we start using the language of heterodox churches, how do we prevent ourselves from adopting that language? And then particularly if we're using it to talk with them. Now, of both these questions, the thing that strikes me personally the most is this prayer is a two-way street idea. That even somehow, if I go to God in prayer, I'm going to get this fuzzy feeling, this moment of peace. And I don't want to deny that the Word of God, when I hear about Christ forgiving my sins, I have relief. There is peace there. But I don't get that off on my own, pouring my heart out to God. If anything, often in my prayers, what I find is a lack of answer and a growing awareness that I need to seek the answer and where to seek the answer, which is in Scripture. So I don't know. How would you want to jump off that there, Dr. Rast?
Yeah, you caught it very nicely, I think, there at the end, Pastor Fisk. The prayer, in a way, is us trying to align ourselves with the revealed will of God. Mm-hmm. That is to say, it drives us further and further into where God has revealed himself, namely in the Scriptures. So, as a pastor, when I served as a pastor down in Tennessee for a number of years before I came on to the seminary, and one of the things that people always asked me was, why doesn't God speak to me? Why doesn't God reveal his will? Why doesn't God tell me exactly what to do? And my response was to, well, of course, you need to pray about this, but as you're praying, be sure you're reading the Scripture, delving into them. Because as you delve into the Scriptures, you're going to hear God reveal his will. You don't seek it as such. It is revealed by him.
Right. As you're saying that.
The seeking deal is kind of, I want to find my answer, the answer that I want.
Right.
What God has actually revealed to me.
Because as you're saying that, what I hear is the way someone could use that and say, okay, so I got my Bible, and I'm praying, and so now I'm looking for the sort of the magic answer on the page. Like, I got to go to college somewhere. I got to pick my college, so I'm going to read, the Old Testament. And somewhere in Chronicles, I'm going to figure out where I'm supposed to go to college, right? Like, that's not what you're saying, right?
No.
So say what you're saying instead. Say it again in a different way.
What I'm trying to say is that as you read the Scriptures, basically what God is giving you is the overall picture of what it is he has given in his Word, in the sense that and this is just kind of a basic thing, given in his Word so that we live as his people, not in the sense that we're looking for a specific answer, kind of a mystical revelation that comes directly, but rather we make the best move that we can using the intelligence that the Lord has given us.
Right, informed by his Word. Right. I keep getting driven back. I know you're gonna agree with this. This is like silly to even try to bring it up to it. In one sense, that I keep getting driven back to the Luther's words about becoming a child before the Ten Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, and how those things, as the summary of God's Word, are enough that I can study them my whole life and still have to be a student of them, and yet have within them everything God really wants to say to me about how I should live my life now. And Brian, you're just jumping in on that. I'm sure this is right up in your house as well, right? The catechism as the antidote to the world's thinking. We're dealing with the question, that first question on kind of the prayer is a two-way street thing. You got this document in front of you with the questions in it, Brian?
Yeah.
Are you that prepared?
Yeah.
Good, okay. And
we're in the show, so he can prep now because we're
Totally okay. Prayer is a two-way street, and then the question of the intimate relationship with Jesus and baggage found in terminology, and these, I think these are connected. What were your thoughts when you looked at those questions, Brian?
Well, this is how we always want is people are always talking about the listening prayer, how when you go to pray you have to listen for God's word. But the problem is if prayer is listening, then you can never say amen, because you can never be sure that what you're hearing is God's word or whatever. I mean, I remember, I don't know how many times in my own life where I was convinced that God had told me something. And it turned out that the thing that I heard was just absolutely untrue. It was completely false. And that puts you on this really, really shaky ground. When Jesus teaches us to pray, he wants us to say amen at the end of the prayer. He wants us to be sure that the thing that we're saying is God's truth, that we're bringing his promises back to him. And if we practice this kind of mystical listening prayer, that is gone. There's no confidence in our prayers at all.
That's where Luther says then in the Large Catechism on the Lord's Prayer how, we can be sure and certain that we have what we ask for, because we're asking for what he told us to ask for. But then this gets to the question behind the question, right? He asks, if we only receive guidance from Scripture, not prayer, what's the point of prayer? why pray? If God's name is holy in and of itself, right? What am I doing asking for it to be holy in my midst? And if he knows what I'm going to ask for, why should I bother doing it at all? Larry, you got an answer for that?
Well, first off, the point again is this is God's word for us. This whole idea of I'm gonna shape my prayer life. I'm gonna be the one who kind of gives it its contours and that sort of thing really misses the whole point. What we're trying to do through prayer is to learn to accept what God has revealed to us in His Word, to see clearly what it is He has said. And it's, you know, typically it's not going to be you should go to Swarthmore or you should go to Cornell. It's going to be
you should go to Fort Wayne Seminary.
Fort Wayne Seminary, but use the gift.
That's a given, yeah.
Yeah. So that's the, you know, the problem in prayer is not God's problem, it's our problem.
Right, right. And so, like the psalmist praying in anger, right? His issue isn't trying to get God to do something so much as him trying to reckon with what God has done. and his sin within him doesn't want to let him do it, and yet he knows that this is what God is doing, and so he cries out, right, how long, O Lord? Brian, you look like you wanted to jump in there. I don't want to cut you off.
Yeah, you know, when Jesus introduces the Lord's Prayer, he introduces it with the thought that God knows what you need. So, you know, a lot of people, we say, well, if God knows what we need, if he knows what's next or whatever, why would you pray? But Jesus says that's the reason that you pray. God knows what you need. And by the way, he tells you what you need when he gives you the Lord's Prayer. You need his word, you need his name, you need his kingdom, you need his will, you need daily bread, you need forgiveness of sins, etc. So that the Lord teaches us to pray precisely because he knows what we need, because because he wants to give us these things. So that, you know, the idea that you know, if God knows all these things, and if I'm not going to learn anything here, if God's not going to directly reveal himself to me, then prayer is useless. Jesus twists that precisely on its head. That's the opposite of why Jesus says we pray.
Right. Luther, again, in the Lord's Catechism, and this is just in my head because I read the Lord's Prayer, Lord's Catechism recently, but it always strikes me that the first reason we pray is because God told us to. Right? Second commandment, call on my name, right? Do it. And so whether or not it gets me anything, this is old Adam saying, what good is it to me to do a righteous work if I don't earn something with it, right? And instead, it's like missing. You have a God who says, use my name in praise, right? And we reject this. Peter, we got a question for Dr. Rast coming in already. Dr. Rast, this is not normal. We don't get
actually,
questions.
Actually, this is early, my so. Question.
Oh, never mind.
Never mind.
So it's not quite as cool. We do have other questions that have come in already, but not particularly related to this topic. Dr. Rast, I had a question regarding this topic, particularly in your bailiwick of pietism, because I think what we're seeing in this question is something that typically happens in American evangelicalism, and I bring that up because a large portion of our audience has come from that background. But it's this move from the objective externals, the word, the sacrament, that coming from outside ourselves to that internal subjective stuff, like we mentioned, the warm fuzzies. And could you talk a little bit about how that has influenced, you know, this question? Is this pietism rearing its head? Where does this come from? Because that seems to be the move we're making, and how has pietism influenced that?
Yeah, it's one of the worst expressions of pietism there. You all are going to, Brian's going to have a heart attack when I say this, but there are some good things about pietism.
Boot him. That's it. He's out.
But now let's move on.
I got a cramp.
The problem, again, the problem with pietism is that it drives everything inward. Mm-hmm. And so when you begin to talk about prayer and pietism, it becomes almost, at least in some cases, the chief means of grace. It becomes the way that you communicate with God, open up the channels for him to work in your life, and kind of allow him to do his thing. So, you know, God's will is thwarted by the human will in this understanding until we can really get our act together and allow him to do the things that he really wants to do. And we can only that can only happen once that we have kind of achieved the state that God wants us to be in. Now, what's that state? The state is often one where it's this kind of, you know, we've called it warm fuzzy. Sometimes it's kind of nasty and unhappy stuff, mm-hmm. right? Where you struggle, and if you haven't gone through all this horrible kind of experience and you haven't just been crushed enough by the law and you haven't felt badly enough, then really your prayer isn't something sufficient to move the heart of God. But this is just bad stuff, frankly, because it continually drops things back on the human subject. How hard are you praying? How sincere are you in seeking the will of God? How really determined are you to make that reality in your life and that sort of thing? And in the end, the promises of God simply are obscured at the best and lost at the worst.
It gives the incurvatus man, the man curved back in on himself, exactly what he wants,
yeah.
which is a toe in the door. I saw someone posted recently in a group I'm in a section of a man describing the life of Samuel Schmucker, I think, kind of a bridging American pietist, right? And describing all the things he'd never done once in his life and how he prided himself on abstinence from everything imaginable that was happy. It was just like... couldn't even laugh, right? He didn't say that, but it was right on the verge of laughter would be out too. And so the old pietists did have this rigid puritanical edge to them. The new pietism, if we want to call it that, is the feelies. You distinguished there at the beginning, I believe, between pietism as a historical phenomenon, which had some corrective things that probably needed to be said, and then the jargon that is used in confessional circles today, in which we mean legalism, right? Mm-hmm. And that's why Brian fell out of his chairs, because he can only conserve things in ahistorical terms, and so he was using the jargon and he fell down.
That's right.
Right, yeah.
I was thinking of, you know, First Temple pietism.
Oh, I've been explaining that one in sermons this summer. That was hard. Second Temple Judaism is not easy. Now I'm losing the other thing I wanted to say, but I think going back to the question on prayer, there is a tendency still amongst those who mean well as American confessional Lutherans to want to see this inner light revelation, and we know it's wrong, and so we turn it into the peaceful feeling. And even that, if you're telling someone to expect that, you're giving them promises God has not given. And that's what scares me about it. It's not that God doesn't create peace, joy, love in the heart of the Christian. But to tell you that that's where you should go when you're in your agony to find God's answers, to me that's a scary, scary thing. In Broken, I don't bring up my book much, but that was an opening section in Broken. What are you guys saying here on the side? Now Peter has another question.
Well, Brian had something else first. He wanted to sing.
I just wanted to sing the Eagles song. I got a peaceful.
Hey, that was in my video on last Thursday for this very reason. I had to find a non-copyrighted version.
I have a Bible verse, though, and this is Romans 10, which is important.
Pietist?
I know. I'm just going to give the wrong chapter reference so then you won't think that I actually know where this Bible verse is.
It is somewhere written. It's somewhere written.
It's somewhere towards the end of Romans.
Yeah.
Paul says, how will they call on him whom they have not believed? And how will they believe on him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? So that when we want to hear from God, where do we go? Do we go into the kind of realm, the theater of our own heart? No, Paul says we find a preacher, and the chief preachers we listen to are the prophets and the apostles, and then the preachers that the Lord has given to us. That's how we know the Lord's word. That's how we hear the voice of God. And anything that would push us away from the word of God and the preachers that the Lord has sent is tempting us to a voice that we can never be sure of. It's destructive of the comfort that the Lord wants for us.
It's silly how he's given us such confidence. There are words written on the page that will never go away, and yeah. we want some other answer. Yeah? You're shaking your head, Dr. Rast.
Yeah.
Say more.
I started that story a little bit earlier where these people would come to me in my church and say, I just want to hear God speak, and I'd say, here's his word.
Right.
Here's his word. Well, I wanted him to say something else.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that's right.
I don't like what he has
to say. I prefer God to say something different.
Yeah. I'd like a different word. Thank you.
That is the truth. You know, the problem with God's word is what he says. Oh, man, we're not trying to target the ELCA tonight, but geez.
If the shoe fits.
Yeah. All right, so hey, it's right,
April. So the devil comes to Adam and Eve in the garden and says, did God really say? And Eve says, oh, I hope so.
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
You just craft Maybe. It to be whatever you want. It looks right. Pretty good to me.
Oh, boy.
Well, and like Dr. Rass is saying, you know, at church, we say this in the liturgy, too. Every reading that I have that's not from a gospel, I finish by saying, this is the word of the Lord. Like, there it is. It's ultimate. It is finished as a statement. You can be certain of it. But I want something more, I don't know, mystical. I want something less certain. Maybe that's just it. Hey. I want the wax to nose God.
No, you want something tailored to you.
Yeah.
Something that is special to you because you are a special person.
Hey, don't tell me what I want to hear.
Well, that setup was a little too.
And you see in that too that there's it's a denial of the sufficiency of God's word because you say, well, hey, look, the Bible might be good for everyone else, but I need a word of God for me. Oh, so the Bible is not enough. I need something more. I mean, that's the dangerous position to be in, to despise the gift that God has given. I mean, the Christian posture is, Lord, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. It's sufficient. It's complete. It's all that I need. But when we demand that special revelation, we're denying the sufficiency of the scripture.
But aren't we hearing this in our own circles in terms of the, what, like, talking baggage in language, baggage of mission language and the need to change for the context that we're in, that these old forms don't really carry the meaning for the current, whatever you want to call it, meta-narrative. This stuff is real slippery. It's not like you don't have to talk to people in their own language. Oh, man, scary to me, though, Brian, what you said there. You're describing those in our own house.
Yeah, the mission movement is a denial of the sufficiency of the word, and especially it's a denial of the efficacy of the word, that God's word is enough. And we always are tempted to think that we need to make God's word more. We need to dress it up. You know, we gotta put lipstick and a pretty dress on God's word so that it's more attractive for the unbeliever. But that's a denial of the efficacy of the word. And to deny the sufficiency and efficacy of the word is to deny the ascension of Jesus. That he does not sit at the right hand of the Father, and that he has not sent the Holy Spirit, that he no longer rules and reigns all things for the sake of his church. And so this is certainly a dangerous path to go down.
Dr. Rast, did you see Andy Stanley's recent comments that have been kind of floating around the internet about if you don't take your children to a mega church, you're selfish and don't care about the future of God's kingdom on earth? Yeah? I'm sure you're telling that to your students to prep to preach just like that, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Is there a danger in that kind of talk?
Yeah, a little bit. So what are they missing? They're missing. Wolf Miller's going crazy again.
Don't worry, I'm just doing a little construction project here in the background.
I'm easily.
Don't mind me.
It's kind of a squirrel factor anytime Wolfenbuehl is involved. But anyway, what are they missing? What are they losing? How are you harming them as a parent when you're giving them, putting them in the midst of the word and the sacraments? What are they missing? A program? Are they missing what do they call it? Children's church? That kind of thing.
They're going to grow up with boring church, and so they're going to hate church and leave. That's where he's coming at it from. But
and it's nonsense because. What could be more fulfilling, particularly for children who are oftentimes more ready to hear than we adults who become calloused and distracted by Wolfenbuehl, but they
as bored as clean.
the point being again that you know this is you're giving them the very words of life. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Give them the words. Let them hear the words. Don't give them cotton candy. Don't give them junk. Don't give them something that's not Jesus. Give them Jesus.
We're going to jump to another question in just a minute, but you made me think of when I was in Naperville, we started a new program for the catechesis. We moved it down to fifth grade, and then we were trying to really encourage parents to get involved. And so we actually allowed you to skip the confirmation classes, provided that you taught the catechism in the home to your child and brought them in for a theological interview. And I had a mom come up to me about 3-4 weeks into this, and she said, "Pastor, I really don't like this new program." And I was, "Okay, well, why? What's wrong with this new program?" "Well, my husband every night is just reading the catechism to our daughter, and that just can't be enough, can it?" And I was like, "It worked! It worked!" You know? 500 years we've been trying to get dads to do this, and we did it. But denying the efficacy, right? That we don't believe that just tell them the words that the father to son and father to daughter is so powerful when you'll just confess these words. I just heard a
that was
lose somebody. Right. Okay. Yeah. It's so powerful when we confess these words, and if we could recapture that alone. Now I'm talking like a pietist wanting to recapture stuff, though. Peter's got another question.
What was that, Brian?
I just want to, you know, the problem with your catechism program, it just doesn't have arts and crafts programs with mini sausages and crazy glue.
That's right.
Let's jump back to the prayer topic. This will be our last question on prayer. It kind of refers to a pretty evangelical practice again, but Jorge was asking, I got to find it here. I scrolled up a little too much. "In my evangelical life, I often attended prayer meetings where multiple folks would submit unspoken prayer requests. It was always goofy to me at the time, but it really seems futile now. How would you address those unspoken prayer requests now?" Have you guys been in prayer time when this is a thing, or somebody raise their hand unspoken? Never had that happen?
Well, I mean, I've been there before too, and so the idea is that, of course, God hears you in the heart, so you don't have to pray on your lips. But this should be the silent prayer, or the prayer in the heart, the meditation of the heart, and so forth, ought to be not the first form of prayer, but rather, you know, I mean, when necessary. But the Bible understands that when we're praying, we're speaking. So that let the meditations of my heart, but that the words of my lips be acceptable in your sight. So we want to be always verbalizing all the prayers that you can. Now, there's times, of course, when we're in church or gathered around or whatever, that we're offering a silent prayer to the Lord. But I don't think that wants to be our default mode for prayer.
Well, the disciples certainly seem to understand the need to be taught what to pray, because they ask for it. They ask for Jesus to teach them to pray. And I think this passage gets abused a bit, but Paul says that the Spirit intercedes for us with groans that words can't express. I've become convinced that doesn't mean that in my greatest moments of prayer, I'm feeling the Spirit speaking these powerful groans. It means that when I'm being a complete nincompoop, the Spirit's praying without me. He's getting it done from the back end with beyond my words. But in terms of if I'm going to pray not just with my spirit but also with my mind, as Paul then says in 1 Corinthians 14, this requires not a babbling language, whether from heart or mouth, but an actual constructed set of words. God himself has given us this in the Psalter. He's given us this in the Lord's Prayer. He's given this in the great cloud of witnesses, which just completely gets diminished in American Protestantism, that there's this history of witness that we've got to be taught how to pray. And in the same way that I had to learn how to walk by having someone hold my hands and carry me, when I learned to play basketball, someone had to show me how to make a layup. Why do I think that praising God Almighty, I can just walk into that one and throw up whatever I want, right? When in every earthly thing, I got to be trained to do this. As a sinner, more than ever, if we believe anything about original sin, I can't. If I'm going to pray to God on my own, I'm going to pray to an idol. I'm going to make up a God I want and pray for things he doesn't want to give me. He's gracious enough, he hasn't done that to us, right? But the ex corde, it's not that your heart shouldn't be involved. It's not that there aren't times when your heart does have prayers to say and you have words to just speak to God. But those words, if they're not being, this goes back to what Dr. said at the very start, if they're not being formed by the scriptures themselves telling us what we are to pray, they are bound to become not hallowed be thy name, but hallowed be my name kind of prayers.
I think
welcome back, Dr. Rast.
Hey, yeah, he jumped out for a little bit there. I want to add to, as a former evangelical, I think most often, I can remember doing this in junior high all the time. I went to a private Christian school, and you know, you have your prayer time, whether it's the beginning of class or whatever. And usually, this would be used when I was too embarrassed to say whatever my prayer request was. I didn't really want to speak it in front of people, but I wanted it to be prayed for. Or there was a bit of, you know, self-righteousness to it, that I wanted people to know that I had a prayer request, that, you know, that there was something there for me to pray for. I wasn't just a loser who didn't have anything to pray for. I didn't want to talk to God. So, I mean, both of those things often are the case where it's just simply, you know what, I'm really embarrassed. I don't want to share this publicly, but I'd like prayer for it. Or the self-righteousness of, I want to look like I have a prayer. And whether I'm embarrassed or not, I just want to look like I have one. And unspoken is kind of a cool way to do that.
Well, let me.
I've listed my silent prayer requests on the board, by the way, back here.
I can see that. Yeah, excellent.
Brian, stop interrupting Dr. Rast, please.
I can
Dr.
Rast, go ahead. Tell Peter that he doesn't have a prayer. So there you go. Oh, there you go.
I interrupted his own insult of me.
Sorry. I remember attending a church where they always had prayer requests brought up with the offering that people could fill out in the pews, and they had a way of doing anonymous prayers there. And the pastor would always say, we pray for one, W-O-N, one person, but he'd just say, for one who has this, one who has this. And for like the first 2 months, my wife thought there was a woman named Juan who just had all this trouble that we kept praying for.
The most afflicted poor lady in the entire congregation.
She finally figured it out. She was so mad.
How did she get
mad? And I think justly so, that people were too embarrassed to like be prayed for. Where's the pride? There's a pride in this too, that I don't want anyone to know my sin. Anyway, we got to go into lightning rounds. Brian, you can have last word. Then we got to go into lightning rounds.
William has a
message. I don't know. I don't know anything else.
Comments.
Oh, Larry has the last word.
What's that?
The wrath shall be first and
word,
last.
Word.
Peter says that you wanted to say something, so I threw it to you.
No, I said William Metz in the comments on YouTube has an unspoken prayer request for you guys.
For us. Now I get it. I get it. Tell him it's between him and him.
I get it. Catching up now.
All right, lightning round.
Swallow his pride and suck it up. Yeah.
Lightning round. We're going to go and try to – this went too long last time, so we're going to try to make this a little bit shorter. We're looking for three sentences. We're going grammar here. Three sentences or less to try to answer these questions and give us an idea. So we'll cut to the chase on this. First question, and we'll go. Brian, Dr. Rast, and myself to let Dr. Rast have an easy time. I am a Reformed guy. A viewer writes, I thought I heard you say you were in a confessional Calvinist church at one point. That's me personally. Why did you leave it for Lutheranism? Can you explain the development of your thought, i.e., and this is for you too if you didn't have this experience, why are you not a Calvinist? Brian.
Well, I was never a Reformed Calvinist, but the reason why I'm not a Calvinist is, number one, the biggest error of Calvinism is it denies the universal atonement. They confess officially over and over that Christ died only for a few, that is, the elect. And that leads to all sorts of other problems, namely a denial of the efficacy of the word and sacraments, and also the doctrine of double predestination and so forth. But it all comes, that is the fountain of error of Calvinism, that ununiversalizing the death of Jesus.
All right, Dr. Rast.
Do I get nine sentences too?
Anyway, yeah, he's on a butt.
Nine sentences. They were dashing.
I am not a Calvinist, but some of my best friends are, and the reason that I'm not a Calvinist is that the first off, to jump on with Brian, the denial of the universal atonement is fundamental and really just puts everything at stake. However, to take a little different twist, the other side of it is that it puts an emphasis on the first and third persons of the Trinity, and obscures Christ as the one through whom and by whom we truly know God.
Give me one more sentence on that. How so? It's good.
Yeah, God the Father is sovereign. He is the one who has made the determination of whether one will be reprobated or elect. The Holy Spirit is the one who renders the effectual call of that decision. Christ just does a little bit of historical action of making the atonement for those who are the elect, but the real players are the Father and the Spirit.
Yeah, good. I did come into the church again after leaving it through a Calvinist preacher preaching the text of Ephesians and Galatians, which was very effective in telling me the difference between grace and the world I was living in. I am not a Calvinist because Calvinists are Orthodox Christians, that is, Lutherans, who have been tainted with the poison of modern rationalism. All the issues Brian mentioned are strictly a matter of the Calvinists coming to Scripture in true, faithful, Orthodox fashion, searching for the answers where they should be searched for, and having Scripture and his reason not come together, and saying, I have to choose one or the other. And reason goes over the Scriptures and forces the Scriptures to submit to it, and you end up with all the doctrines that Brian mentioned. I don't know if I can draw a nice tight bow around it connected to what Dr. Rast said about the Trinity, although that's pretty spot on there. I've seen that now that you mention it, the diminishing of Christ behind the other two. But for me, it's about the rationalism of the whole thing. They are the heresy of modernism in its most Orthodox form.
I'm going to add one sentence, my answer. I like assurance. Yeah. I like knowing that I'm actually saved. And I think most Calvinists, the reason they leave it is because they realize I have no assurance.
This is an apple.
This represents the apple that sits on high in the produce aisle.
Question number two. As a Lutheran, did I make the right decision to stop dating a Mormon because of our religious differences, despite the fact that I'm pretty broken about it today? Any encouragement? Brian?
You made the right decision. God will bless it.
Why? I agree. Why?
So you, Paul says, don't be unequally yoked, and I think it especially applies to this, that when you are standing facing the world together, especially as husband and wife, that if you do not have the same understanding of God who created us, died for us, and who sanctifies us, then this is fertile ground for the devil to work and attack your faith and also to attack your love for each other. And it's dangerous. Now, it's not to say that if you're in a marriage and one is a Mormon and the other is a Christian that you should, of course, leave the marriage. No, the Lord has bound you together. But when you have some choice about it, find an Orthodox gal.
If or you
guy. I didn't see who this was.
Yeah, there's no name with it. But, yeah, way to assume your own gender into the conversation.
All right, look at that. Jeez.
Yeah. Dr. Rast. Conscience is a mirror.
Well, I mean, golly, what a difficult thing. You find yourself in a relationship like this, and now the religious differences come to the forefront. But if this Mormon person is a convinced Mormon, it really is going to cause some issues. And so you have to be upfront and address them on the in an immediate way and a direct way. So, yeah, you make that call. It's hard. That doesn't make the breakup any easier. But nevertheless, there are things that the Lord will work this out. There is a sense in which down the path you're going to be able to look back and say, okay, yeah, that was the right thing to do. No question about it.
And I'd agree with both the gentlemen so far. It is absolutely the right decision. The American lie of love and marriage is that you got these two people staring at each other forever. They're going to look deeply into each other's eyes, and they're going to find some sort of peace and harmony there. But true love is two people standing, as Brian said, not knowing he was being so clever at the moment, standing together staring in the same direction. They're not looking at each other, looking forward towards something. And if you can look toward the last day of Jesus' return, trusting in the same hope, you're going to have a foundation for your marriage that no one else in this world can even dream of. Even if you're just looking toward your bank account, you got some security with each other and that you got the same aims and the same goals. Throw into that your spiritual reality and it becomes that much more strong. So I can't encourage you enough to, like Brian said again and Dr. Rast as well, if the emotions are tight now, that's fine, because far better when you have the choice in the matter to find somebody who's looking the same direction that you are while you're going to walk till death. It's a long time. just ask Brian's
wife.
Plus,
if you marry a Mormon, then you've got to cultivate a whole planet worth of children. You know,
that's
a tough afterlife. You know, have you seen in the temple, in the Mormon temple, where you go to get married for time and eternity, and they got these big mirrors on each side, so you kneel on the cushion facing each other, and you look, and there's a thousand of your spouse going off into the... It's really kind of creepy.
That is very creepy. Did you live through this, Brian?
I was there.
I toured
the Mormon temple before. They built this tabernacle in Albuquerque, and before they consecrated to do the Mormony stuff, they let the people go through, and we saw it all, you know.
Right.
But that's only you can only get married for eternity if you're both temple worthy Mormons. Otherwise, you just get married for time, you know. It's right.
Poor Carrie, to have to kneel there and look at 1,000 Bryans all in a row.
I know. Each getting smaller and smaller in stature.
Question. Question number three, back to mysticism. Have you heard of the term, quote-unquote, God sightings? And what is your opinion of this? There are lots of materials available in support of this activity, year-long devotional study guides, etc. Brian, any God sightings recently?
No, I've never heard of it. So go to Dr. Rast, and I'll have heard of it by the time it comes back to me.
Okay, Dr. Rast?
I have no idea what you're talking about. What in the world is a God sighting?
I think this is like... go ahead, Peter. Go ahead.
Well, this is an evangelical thing. Another way to ask this is, how have you seen God working today? Where, when you're out in the world doing your daily work, or on a mission trip, if you're out on a mission trip, where did you see God acting? Where did you see God working? That's usually where this sort of thing would come into play.
Another common way of saying it is it was a God thing. We had this thing happen, and it was a God thing. What it is it's the holy coincidence, right, that we're going to find the sign that has taken place in my present day and blame it on God. My problem with this comment is that it is an evil and wicked generation that ask for a sign. That is the words of our Lord, and I take him at face value. No sign will be given to this adulterous generation but the sign of the prophet Jonah. Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days, 3 nights, so the Son of Man will be in the belly of the earth. That is the sign that has been left for us until he returns. In many and various ways, God spoke to his people of old by the prophets, but now, these last days, spoken to us by his Son. So I'm going to listen to that one sign, which is the incontrovertible historical fact of the resurrection of Jesus from the dead, which I think is pretty much worth it. I'm going to let that be my God sighting, that the witnesses who eyewitnessed this thing and have left their words for us about it, that'll be my God sighting. And I'll let providence, as it expresses itself in the world, be under the first article. It's a gift from God, but I'm not going to try to find his will in the midst of it, because I'm still going to find evolution and a lot of death out there, and in the resurrection of Jesus, I'm going to find what we were talking about earlier, confidence, assurance, certainty, and the like. Man, you could publish that. Go, Brian.
It's recorded. That's okay. We can go back and transcribe that.
No, it's true. I mean, when people say God sightings, it's normally like, you know, a kid in diapers feeding a dandelion to a baby duck or something like that, you know?
Where are you getting your God sightings from?
I mean, you know, it's always some like really nice sort of thing that happens.
Yeah.
I mean, you know,
yes,
it's a God thing.
Yes.
Like I was walking down the street and the car splashed mud on the person behind me and on the person in front of me, but not on me. You know, that's a God thing. But here's the question: is that can we identify the cross as a God thing?
Yes.
I mean, the good thing about a God sighting is that we realize that God is, in fact, involved in this world. We're not kind of practical atheists, and that all the things that the Lord that happened to us, that the Lord's hand is involved in these things. We're not trying to interpret them, read God's anger or love into them. We're just seeing that God is, in fact, involved. But are our eyes tuned to see the death of Jesus and the suffering of the Christian, the cross that he lays on us, as God's work? And I'm afraid that the God sighting is going to be directing our eyes away from these sorts of things and towards the Louis Armstrong songs.
Yeah, we're looking for glories of the cross.
Yeah, it's not the Lord's Supper or baptism. That's not a God sighting.
Yeah, right.
Go, Dr. Rast.
Well, I mean, you end up with kind of the Joel Osteen approach to things, where the God sighting becomes, in one of his books, he tells a story about getting a parking place closer to the mall because he prayed more fervently or something ridiculous like that. And you know, come on.
Right.
You could have parked way out since you're in such good shape and left that spot open for the little old lady who actually needed to get in the mall for something. You probably had your personal assistant out doing it. So, I mean, it just, again, it just comes back around in the way of us promoting ourselves and our own desires, and those become the evidence of God's action in our lives when we like what happens, rather than being able to see when God is truly active in our life in the most difficult of circumstances.
On the cross, yeah. I've got cancer, and I still believe in Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a God sighting, you know? I haven't abandoned him. Oh, amen.
We have to remember, too, that we walk by faith and not by sight, you know, so that faith comes by hearing, not by seeing. And we are so addicted to our eyes that it's, Jesus gives his gifts to us through our ears.
Right. But if you had more faith, Brian, you would get a parking place closer.
That's true.
Or at least see a closer parking space.
Yeah.
That's right. Or at least not see the handicap sign there.
All I can say is that the art that Brian hasn't changed for a while is hurting my eyes, so he needs to get rid of Calvin and move on to something else while I read the next question, which he's going to have to answer. This is a tough one, guys. This one's kind of hard. Viewer writes, I recently found out that my friend struggles with self-harm. I think you could read that as self-mutilation. How do we as Christians respond to this? That's tough.
I do not understand the self-harm thing. From what I've read about it, there is this the way that for the people that are, you know, cutting themselves and practicing this sort of stuff are saying that they're almost numb to the world, and so they want to feel something, so that there's some way that you can stir up some feeling because your life is so full of a kind of a numbness. It's kind of the result of a hardened conscience or a conscience that can't sense the kind of the tender beauty that is all around us, and so it's trying to break out of that. It is the it's a particularly difficult situation, and I think probably in this case you want a combination of family and pastoral care and theological conversation all around the person, and if you know, and if there's other help to be brought in, maybe even medical help too, depending on how things are. But the what you're looking for, I think the opposite of self-harm is this thing that the Bible always talks about, and that's delight. That we delight in the Lord. We delight in His Word. We delight in His gifts. We delight in creation. And a life filled with delight is the opposite of this life where everything is flat and there's nothing, there's no feeling at all unless there's pain. And so that's, I think, the thing that we want to be working towards in our conversation. But this is a difficult and complicated situation.
You want to jump in there?
Yeah, the well, I mean, you see the evidence of the whole creation groaning under the effects of sin here. And whether it's the kind of thing that Brian was just describing with the person harming themselves, kind of whatever the case might be, or self-medicating in some other fashion, trying to overcome the pain that the reality of sin creates in every human being's existence. The only way out of that pain, of course, is Christ and the promises of God in the gospel. Bringing that, recognizing that, you know, there are plenty of biblical examples where we see people harming themselves and struggling with these kind of realities. The reality of sin, the reality of the demonic, and how that challenges us at every point as something that is not far away 2,000 years ago, but a present reality here in 2016 is something that we have to take seriously. So, you surround this with the Word of God, the sacraments, bring this person into the context of the church. It doesn't mean they're going to stop doing that necessarily, but it's going to give them hope.
You mentioned the demonic, and I think that's fair on two levels. There is an example of a man who cut himself in the scriptures, and he was a man possessed by a legion of demons. So I don't think that things are entirely divided. And there is also a sort of medieval habit of thinking of the demonic as being magical, that they're, you know, the demons are out in the alleys, they're going to throw a boulder on your head. The demons are in the lies, they're in the worldviews, they're in the false philosophies, their strongholds are arguments. And if there is any connection to cutting within the youth today that we see, I think it's to this predominantly nihilistic worldview. So the numbness that Brian was describing is them coming to the logical conclusion of what they're being taught, that there is nothing. And the postmodern philosophers have said to us that therefore the only thing that is the present experience. Okay, well, so now you have this kid who's 12 who believes there's nothing and has only the present experience, and they've sought pleasure in all that they can, and it's been given to them. There's Solomon in Ecclesiastes. I have expanded pleasure to the nth degree. I can find no more pleasure. What do I have left? I'm bored with pleasure. Well, you got pain. That's what you got left. And so they go searching it. When you're dealing with the demonic, I'm no expert on this. Do you exercise? Do you pray? What is the next step in that? I think if the person is willing to hear words about Jesus, you're in one spot. If the person is refusing to hear words about Jesus, you're in another. But prayer, I mean, the disciples who had the power to cast out demons at times, the only thing they could do was pray. And that is where you got to start with this one. And don't treat it lightly. This is dangerous stuff. Don't act as if you're somehow invulnerable to it as well. Stay connected to your own catechesis as you pray for and engage this friend. Brian, you got more to? I mean, you look
just
like
one more. One more thing that the Bible always talks about the importance of the blood, that the life is in the blood, and so especially when someone's pouring out their own blood, this is a place to say that look, we have a better blood, a blood that avails before the Father, the blood of Jesus. And so it is not that we have an unbloody religion. In fact, we have the opposite. We have a bloody Bible, a bloody religion. We have the blood at the supper. It's not your own blood that's required of you. The blood of Jesus, it covers you. And that is often profoundly something that someone who, you know, understands the importance of blood is hopefully a connection to be able to hear the gospel.
I like to joke about this, but no one ever gets it because no one's a fantasy nerd, but we have blood magic. We have a blood magic religion, which in all fantasy is the darkest magic, but in our religion it is the source of light. I love it. I think it's great. All right, next question. Love the show. Y'all are great except for Brian. Some Lutherans have told me – there was an editor remark there. Lutherans have told me that we don't use systematic theology but instead use dogma. Others say we do use systematic theology. I'm confused. I'm willing to bet this was covered in your seminary. Can you explain what I'm missing?
Uh-oh. Dr. Rast? I wonder if this was covered in my seminary.
Between dogma and systematics, Dr. Rast?
When I was a college student and I was a theology minor at a Lutheran college, I couldn't understand what systematic theology was, just couldn't get it at all. So I was on the right track right from the beginning. But, I think probably what he's heard here is the distinction between systematic theology is kind of system, philosophical / theological system at the expense of the church's historic teaching. Others will say systematic theology is the appropriation of the church's historic confession expressed dogmatically, that is, in terms of the fides quae, the faith that is delivered once to the saints. So you just have to ask the question, what is the person talking about? It can be a messy thing and an unhelpful thing. It can also be a very, very helpful thing. So just cut to the chase, get the idea of what the person's actually talking about.
Brian?
Yeah, I agree. That's why I got an A in Dr. Rest's class where he taught that. You know, what we often talk about a system is you have an overlay, and there's a complete system. So you have a you're logically building things up. How are you building your doctrine? Are you piecing it together in a logical way? And the people who say we have a dogmatic but not a systematic would say that no, we go to the scriptures and we let our teaching grow out of what the prophets and apostles confess in the scriptures, and that's our dogmatic. And that's right. That we our doctrine is the scriptures' doctrine, and we say no more than the scriptures say, and we say no less than the scriptures say. And going systematic would tempt you to try to fill in the blanks where the Bible doesn't say anything, and that's a great theological danger.
But that's relying on a pretty narrow definition of systematics, though, too, I think. And so you really want to distinguish the ideas from the words. Not all teachers who would say systematics, therefore, are trying to get a doctrine different than the scriptures. When I was at St. Louis, I'm sure it's not like this at Fort Wayne at all, but the various schools, the exegetical faculty, the faculty, and the historical faculty, they all kind of like would play against each other and pretend like their department was the best department, and somehow they had a leg up on truth. And at first I was like, as a young theologian, didn't know anything, I'm like, oh, I should really choose one of these, and I'm going to be an exegetical theologian, or I'm going to be a systematic theologian. And then it kind of struck me, like, if you divorce any one of these things from each other, you're in big trouble. You have what Scripture says. You have exegesis. The Scriptures speak. Systematics is our attempt to confess it back. We're trying to put this into a structure to speak it back to God, and we're doing this in the timeline of the history of the church with the witnesses behind us that are saying it to us. And you need all these things together. If there's a department we should get rid of, it's the practical department, because they're just making stuff up. And although, in theory, we should be practicing our confession. So systematics should be very practical in its own right. I also, going on what Brian said there, I had a young lady we had a study group this Sunday afternoon for the youth group. We started looking at the Large Catechism, and she asked a really pertinent question. She said, how do we distinguish between doctrine and Jesus? How do we not begin to worship the idea of doctrine? I thought it was a very good question, because she's getting at what Brian's talking about, that we've got this made-up system that we are talking about, and it's kind of this thing we can look at and keep over there. And if that's what we think of when we say pure doctrine, we're wrong. But if by pure doctrine I mean that I believe in God the Father Almighty who made heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ his Son who died and rose again, and in the Spirit who forgives my sins, and the church, well, now I'm not dividing Jesus from the stuff. This stuff is Jesus. This is what he's left us. And so if that's the distinction, that's a good one. But I'm not confident, you guys can disagree with me on this, I'm not confident that defining or distinguishing between systematics and dogmatics is that professional a distinction in Lutheranism that it always must be divided as the two different things, if that makes sense. So, although Brian thinks so.
not an ism. Lutheranism is not an ism.
Okay, here's a softball. Softball to close out lightning rounds. What is your opinion of Eugene Peterson's paraphrase, The Message? Should it be used in worship for scripture readings and benedictions? Bible studies, are you aware of any official LCMS opinion on The Message? To date, I cannot find one.
There
can't
is
hit this one.
No LCMS opinion on this, but I'll give it to you now.
Okay. Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
I met Eugene Peterson last summer, and I thought that we'd meet him, and the first thing he'd say was, "I'm sorry for doing The Message." But he didn't.
But he didn't say it.
Stuff, but
he likes it. He likes it.
Bad.
Yeah. I've never found a useful part of it. So.
Well, it's flush with his theological opinions. That's the biggest problem. It is not a translation. It is a commentary on the scriptures. And if it were published as such, fine, it's a commentary on the scriptures. But then you don't use a commentary on the scriptures in your worship service. You use a translation. Yeah. And there's always interpretation and translation, but it really goes over the deep end on that.
Yeah.
So, and I got no points for that from Brian for some reason. You want to say, give a little more professional opinion, Dr. Rast?
Like the Scofield Reference Bible, where you end up with commentary via the notes that ends up intruding on the scriptures themselves.
Right. I also personally, as an author or a writer, am offended by his need to fit every American cliche into Jesus' mouth over the course of four Gospels. He really went out of his way to do so. I don't want to bash Peterson, though. He's got some good work on pastors being pastors and not administrators and things like that. It's, you know, it's worth looking at. But if it's being used in an LCMS church, I think we might not have a position on it, but most pastors who care about the Bible are not going to like that idea.
Exactly.
So. Peter says, we've got another question out of the viewership before we go into the books, and it's from an actual Baptist, which...
Whoa.
Yeah. So, bring it on.
I don't know if this is our token Baptist viewer, because we do have 92 viewers right now, if anybody
was
wondering. So, you know, we're kind of finished.
Now I'm feeling the pressure.
Yeah, you're not used to that
like
kind of attention,
radio.
Are you?
There's like three people out there.
That's 87 more than Table Talk Radio listeners.
Dang, I'm scared.
You're welcome.
So
our
viewer here, let me get to this. Justin Haney says, I'm a Baptist, and I've been reading the confessions and have to admit that logically they make sense. But does the Baptist view of baptism, i.e. it's a symbol and doesn't save, basically make it invalid in the Lutheran Church? He's wondering if baptism as practiced by the Baptist would invalidate a baptism were he to go to a Lutheran church.
I'm gonna
is
jump
this
on
lightning
this one.
Round still? Three sentences?
Yes. No, well, yeah, it is lightning rounds, but I'm going to jump on this one and just say that our historic position is that it does not. That if a baptism is given in the name of the formula that Jesus left us by a church which confesses the creedal faith, that is, does not deny that Jesus is actually God, one with the Father, then we trust his words to be sufficient to do what they say. In one sense, Luther says at the start of the Large Catechism on baptism that a Christian must be taught what this means because without it, he cannot be saved. And he doesn't mean that you don't have to know what it means to be saved, but that it saves you by what it is and what it does. And mm-hmm. within the Trinitarian world where Jesus' words are retained, it still has its effect. Now, that doesn't mean you want to align with a church that won't promise you that and tells you it means something different, because what's it for? To create faith in your heart, and you can't trust it if you're being told not to trust it every week from the pulpit. Right, Brian?
Yes. It is. There's an irony how we look at the validity, for example, of baptism and the Lord's Supper. So we look at the words of institution, and when Jesus institutes baptism, he binds up to baptism the confession of his name, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so we say that any baptism done in the confession of the Holy Trinity with the name of God is a true baptism, even if the doctrine of baptism is wrong. That's not the case with the Lord's Supper, because Jesus has bound up the validity of the Lord's Supper to the word, this is my body and this is my blood shed for you. So if someone doesn't have that word, the doctrine of the Lord's Supper, then they don't have a valid Lord's Supper. But with baptism, you can get the doctrine of baptism wrong and still have the great gift of baptism, and we rejoice in that, because that means everyone who's baptized in a Trinitarian church has a valid baptism, and God be praised for that. Now, the opposite is not true. Most Baptists will not recognize the Lutheran baptism as valid if it's done for a baby. So they, while we say that their baptism is valid, they would invalidate our baptism done to children.
Well, and I would say it's not just because it's done to a baby, but it's done without it being a decision or an act of the will on the part of the individual. So either way, the whole point is that outward sign of the inward commitment is what makes it a valid baptism.
Right. Dr. Rass?
And also the mode, that it needs to be by immersion. So,
yeah. Sure.
Which in the end leads you back around to our typical point here. There are so many conditions that are placed upon the baptism on the part of the human subject that you wonder, did I do it right?
Right.
And the point that we're making here, that Brian made very beautifully, is that this is all about God's action here. And baptism in the name of the Holy Trinity does what it says.
Yeah, the word in and with the water. All right, book time. Time for Uncle Brian's boring book hour. We need some music for this.
I got checking the score, by the way, on the lightning round.
Look careful, loser.
Jonathan Fisk, 202.5
2025?
No, that's a... I came in second with the 732. Dr. Rass snuck by with 733 points.
I didn't get any points this time? I got nothing? Oh, man.
I find it ironic how that score always kind of looks the same at the end of every one of these
episodes. Take it easy.
Hey, I'm excited about Boring Book Hour, though, because I got some good boring books this time. So I want to jump into it, but I'm going to make Brian go first because I want to see his book. He's read 10 pages of it, and he thinks he knows what it's about now.
I've read the first 10 pages of this textbook. Can you see
your
that?
Fingers covering it?
The Great Conversation, A Historical Introduction to Philosophy by Norman Melchert. So I've been talking with Dr. Gregory Schulz. We've been doing a radio thing and going through his master metaphors of the of philosophy. It's kind of, I mean, every time it feels like I float a little further out to sea, and pretty soon I'm going to fall over the edge of the world. We just talked about Immanuel Kant's groundwork for metaphysics and morals today. Boy. But anyway, this is the textbook that I'm using to pull out the background for this stuff, and it actually turns out to be a pretty handy book to have in your library because it's a nice combination both of original, I mean, it has a lot of original works in there as well as the commentary on it. So I've read, I think I've read at least the first 7 pages of this book.
So, yeah, it was, it's the great conversation until they decided that words didn't mean anything, right? And then it got kind of tough to talk to each other. That's right about Kant.
Mumbo jumbo.
Now, with the Immanuel Kant part there, did you get to where he invented the concept of worldview, or at least the word for it? Because that was him. Started with him. Weltbild.
I think Immanuel Kant is perhaps the most ironic name in the history of the world.
God can't do it.
Do you know his mother was a
God
Lutheran
with us can't
as
be.
Well? Wasn't his mom a Lutheran pietist, and that's kind of what pushed him away from the faith?
Yeah, he grew up Lutheran. Go figure. Everybody grew up Lutheran. It's amazing. Okay. More people grew up. It's you know, if you, every person you meet grew up in the Lutheran church. I don't know how that happened. Anyway, that's all I got for boring book hour for me.
All right.
Talk about boring. I got a philosophy textbook.
That was boring. You win.
I'm asleep already.
Dr. Rast, what do boring college professors read in their spare time?
I can't find my iPad, so all I have here is an old copy of the Confessional Lutheran from 1959.
Whoa.
It's a little magazine that used to come out within the Missouri Synod telling everything that was wrong within our church body. So it's very fun to read, but that was to make me look pious. What I actually read this last week was an oral history of the band The Replacements.
Oh.
The Who?
No, The Who's a different band, Peter.
Oh.
The what?
I've heard of The Replacements, but I don't know much about them. What's an oral history of The Replacements?
Well, they were a band from Minneapolis that formed in the late 70s, early 1980s, a very troubled group of young men. So some of the topics we were talking about before were are very apropos in their case, but shows what's interesting about them is the way they struggle with the basic realities of growing up in the 1970s and into the 1980s in American culture without a religious, meaningful religious compass. Very
funny. Yeah. Huh. Now, Brian doesn't like it when we talk about secular books, Dr. Rast, just so you know. He got mad last time.
No, secular books are fine. It's just about, like, the dragon elf slaying Klingon and space nonsense.
That's right.
It's like reading poetry.
Oh, that's all I've got this month. You're going to love this one.
Yeah.
Go, Peter. Go. Break Brian's heart.
Here we go. Walther's Long Gospel.
Oh.
Psyched you out. I realized as I was looking for a book, this is actually the only one I've cracked open in the last 2 months. I haven't read any dragon fantasy books recently.
Don't read anymore, anyways.
I've been posting the different theses on the LCMS Facebook page and getting some pretty good response. So this is what I have actually been reading.
What's
for
it about?
For the first time, I might add. I mean, I've never actually gone fully through it. I went through Plessis Handling the Word of Truth. That was fantastic. And now going through this, you know, digging even deeper into that is really great.
Brian, just so you know, when you cough over your shoulder and put your mouth like this, like you're doing, but the microphone is in your earpiece that you're actually trapping between your mouth and your hand, it doesn't work to
slide.
Yeah. It doesn't work. Peter, for someone who hasn't been into Law and Gospel, though, what is it? What is that book? What does it teach?
That, you know, it's basically how to... Well, you got the subtitle here, How to Read and Apply the Bible. Most basically, it's how to understand what God's Word says. It is one of the hardest things for an evangelical coming into Lutheranism is to understand how God's Word speaks to us. God's yes and God's no is another shortened, condensed version of this. But just understanding that there is a right way to understand God's Word and that it's actually been given to us already. This is, you know, It's extremely helpful. I'll say that.
I found God's yes and God's no to be very helpful when I was first kind of exploring Lutheranism, because it took that actual text and just abridged it, edited it for brevity. And the idea that God has spoken twice, he's got these two words that he's saying over and over again, and one says what is but doesn't give the power to save, and one says what has been done by him and does give the power to save, to distinguish those two things from each other, not confuse them. It's a tremendously wonderful, freeing idea. I am reading, I got three books for you. I've been on a tear. I say that half as a joke, but when I was at Fort Wayne for a symposium this year, I was down at the bookstore poking around, seeing how many of my books were left, because that's what I do when I go in there. What I was really checking was I heard there'd been a small run on an evaluation of the claims of the charismatic gifts by Douglas Judish, which, Dr. Rast, I don't even know this, but we've got your print house down there cranking that thing out every couple of months.
Yeah,
or so.
We're keeping it selling.
Fantastic work. Yeah. But I found this and the series of Marquardt's works being published by Christian News Press, lovely little section. So I just picked up the first one, his popular writings, and started paging through it. And man, I knew Marquardt was good. His Ecclesiology in the Confessional Lutheran Dogmatics series is a fantastic book. But his writing is really good. And if I had not just recently succeeded in killing our newsletter, so I don't have to write a little letter at the front of every month, I would be plagiarizing this thing like nobody's business. He's got a page and a half on topical things. It is phenomenal. And he even made his way into my sermon last week on baptism. He just made me think about it again so well. So Kurt Marquardt, if you never discovered him, and this little, I mean, if Christian News does something good in the world, getting these works into people's hands would actually be it. Then on the recommendation, I don't know where I found this actually, but I've been reading James Smith's How Not to Be Secular, reading Charles Taylor. Taylor is a philosopher, I don't know what tradition he's in, but of the last 100 years, whose tome about this big nobody can read. And so James Smith has taken it to heart to put that in layman's terms, and it's trying to distinguish what the secular age really is. In most people's minds, the secular age is like this leaving behind of the religion and finding the world without God. And Taylor shows how this is really fundamentalism on two levels. You have the Christian or the religious fundamentalists and the atheistic fundamentalists who are fighting each other as if there's kind of an either-or reality, when the real change that brought about the secular age is the ability to choose between the two and to have doubt and belief at war within each other within a culture. I'm still not sure I understand all of it, but it is a thought-provoking little book. This was published recently by Mark Burkholz, Jacob Corzine, and Jonathan Mummy, three guys who I knew, all, I think, St. Louis graduates, unfortunately. Jacob went to Fort Wayne, okay. And this is a collection of essays on preaching. These are young guys, and they're trying to make a little mark on the world.
We can't read it. Hold it still, we can't read the title.
I'm trying to get the angle right here. Preaching in a World... Feasting in a Famine of the Word, Lutheran Preaching in the 21st Century. They did a really good job of mixing the essays between young guys who aren't known and some more well-known names. So you got a John Pluss essay in here. You got a David Peterson essay. You got a Stephen Paulson essay in here. Kleinig is in here. But then you have some other newer names, Roy Coates, Paul Elliott, Richard Serena. The opening essay by John Bombaro of Grace Lutheran Church in San Diego, California, on, let me see if I can get the title of the essay here, because it again was just phenomenally done. Is there a text in this sermon, he asks. His task was to do a survey of evangelical sermons looking for their mode, trying to figure out what they're actually preaching. That was valuable, but more valuable was the introduction of the essay, in which he tries to assess the dominant ideology of America that informs all preaching that we do ever, and he says it's not theology, it's not sentimentalism, it's consumerism. No. The marketing is what drives everything, and it struck me as a pastor how much this influences me. I'm trying to marketism all the time. That's what I'm trying to do. Phenomenal little work. I haven't read the rest of the essays in here, but I know they have hopes that guys like you, Dr. Rast, will pick this up and force people to read it in class and things like that. So that's what I've been reading.
Did you just say you haven't read the rest of the essays? Who did a review for the back cover of that book?
Not me.
I thought you did.
Oh, wait, hold on. No, I wrote the introduction.
Oh, the introduction. Okay.
Syncbile. Your friend Syncbile did the review, my friend.
I thought you wrote the review.
No. I wrote an introduction, and it's not even the introduction. What is it, the foreword? The foreword.
Yeah, it's foreword.
I'm kind of proud of it because it's incredibly not like the rest of the book. It is like stream of consciousness weird. I'm trying to think of the poet from the Northern California, 1970s, starts with a
Klingon. One of the Klingon guys.
No, it was this, almost beatnik poet who would always write this really low, earthy stream of consciousness stuff, and that's sort
Jack
of what
Kerouac?
I tried to do. Oh, he would have known Kerouac, but it wasn't. Bukowski? Bukowski. Charles Bukowski. I'm trying to be like him in theology. all right.
Now let's have more drinks yet.
Yeah, I'm sitting here staring at this thing, so I'm going to pour my Kirkland brand fake Jack Daniels. they didn't have the regular Kirkland brand, which is pretty good, so I picked
Dr.
this stuff Rast up.
Dr. Rast is going to be like 2 in the morning over there where you are. You're about to out, I imagine.
Or you go over our hour. At least he's sticking around.
Well, we got our last 15 minutes here, and we'll jump into that, and we'll make everyone say what they're drinking, but... let's just kick around everyone's favorite topic in the last year in online Lutheranism, sanctification.
Oh, we have a question about that, too.
Well, we can bring it up then.
Game of Thrones. Oh, and we can add Deadpool now, I suppose.
Well, Ned Stark died because he was sanctified. That's his problem. He did the right thing. That's why they killed him. And that's the theology of Game of Thrones. Don't do
was
the right thing.
Was he killed by a dwarf?
No.
No. There aren't dwarves in that one. Wrong one. There are dragons, but no dwarves.
So
you gotta watch out for the elves, you know, they get a little crazy.
No, there's no elves in that one either, man.
Klingons?
No.
Klingons?
Even further.
Brian, your life must be very, very dull. That's all
did Q show up to debate the reality of the universe?
How do you know who Q is, Brian?
Yeah, that's a good question.
I don't know, man. WEtv hangouts.
Only certain people know who Q is, and they are not the people that you want to be associated with.
Yeah, that's pretty eclectic information. Wait, you know who Q is, Fisk. What does that
here's
say?
Our question. I used to watch it with my parents.
Ow.
The new ones are good. And there's a third one coming out, which Brian doesn't know about, because it's about elven Klingons. why?
Look,
here,
I mean, those Klingons, you know, need to just pour the ring.
We just lost 10 viewers. It must have been the Trekkies.
We poured the drinks, and it immediately descended into madness. We didn't
I haven't
even
poured mine yet. It's still sitting here.
Brian, you're
okay,
fired.
I'm ready for the sanctification question.
All right. I think this is a great question because it gets at the heart of it. Why do Lutherans not stress sanctification like I often hear at my Baptist church? I grew up LCMS. My wife is a Baptist. We're looking at coming back to the Lutheran church, but this is an area holding us back. Keep up the work, good work, and thank you. So why don't we stress sanctification?
This is the so when John the Baptist preached, he said these words, which I think we need to key in on this question. Who warned you to bear fruit in keeping with repentance? So that good works are always understood as the fruit of repentance, of contrition and faith. And the way you get fruit is not by, you know, you can't go out and tape, you know, apples to your pine tree and think you have pineapples. You can't go out and, you know, duct tape peaches to the apple tree and say you've got fruit. You can't go out and kind of squeeze the trunk of the tree and hope that, you know, fruit will come out of it. The way that you pay attention to the fruit is by paying attention to the tree. So that good works are always the result of repentance, and what the scriptures would have us do is give our attention to repentance. Now, that's not to say that the Bible doesn't give instructions on how we live, the shape of our love, both for God and for our neighbor, of course. But we understand that they are a result, that they're a symptom. And that's why the Lutherans will always say stuff like, our opponents say that we forbid good works. Not only do we not forbid good works, we teach good works, and we show how they're done. Namely, by the strength and power of the gospel, that through contrition and faith the Lord is bringing about the good work of subduing the devil and bringing his order and rejoicing in his gifts in the world.
Now, since we've been talking about pietism and now sanctification, Brian, what are you drinking there?
I got some brandy from the Costco. Costco brandy.
Nice.
This is a big bottle.
Brian, you mentioned John the Baptist, and I thought you were going somewhere else, and what you did was good, but I'm going to do it better. Which is doubly ironic given what I'm about to say. So I think these words are just as key. He said, I must decrease, he must increase. And whenever we get into a conversation about sanctification, by it we mean me assessing my own fruit. I am not decreasing in that equation. I am attempting to increase and see my increase and be able to show you, hey, look, I increased. If I am decreasing in myself, which is what repentance is, to loathe self but hide self beneath Christ, then even if my good works do increase, I'm not sitting there looking at them saying, hey, check out my good works. I'm doing pretty well. If I'm really doing the good work, I'm looking at God or I'm looking at my neighbor. I'm not looking at me anymore, right? And so I love those words from John the Baptist. I don't live them particularly well, but his preaching to me is that if I am going to be sanctified, if I am to be holy, I'm to be out of the picture so far as my own eyes are concerned. My eyes aren't made to look at myself. I'm made to see God and my neighbor. Brian's writing something to distract Dr. Rast right as I give the topic to Dr. Rast.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, more? What are you drinking, Fisk?
Oh, I said already, Kirkland brand
bad whiskey.
Yeah. Dr. Rast can share. He's got IPA, though.
I have a Saranac IPA, Legacy IPA. Very nice. From New York State, upstate New York. So, Lord, when did we see you? Lord, when did we serve? When did we, the whole point, again, of the Lord's discourse in Matthew 25 is that you carry these things out because of who you are, not in order to advance yourself and to catalog the good works that you've done and above all, to quantify them. And that, I think, is one of the real problems with the conversation as it typically goes on, particularly within the context of pietism or the Reformed tradition more generally. It becomes a matter of discerning whether you're a true Christian or not, not by virtue of what Christ has done for you, but by virtue of what you do for Christ. And that has things skewed, turned around, just got it all wrong.
Now, maybe I'm wrong in this. I don't hear... When I hear good Lutheran preaching, I don't come away thinking, well, thank God I can go do evil now since I've been set free. I come away, I heard the law, and it wasn't like it had to be law gospel as a structure for the sermon. The guy preaches the text. He convicts me. He tells me the good news. He convicts me some more. He continues to remind me who I am in Christ. I come out of there, and I don't need you to like hold my hand and say, well, now you better figure out what to do next. The law has been preached, and it hasn't. I believe it, right? It's what I want to be now. I've been made a child of God. I want to be that. And so I'm still looking for this antinomianism. I still don't see it. Not in the Missouri Synod. I'm sure there's some guys out there in corners doing wacky stuff, but I'm waiting to see the preacher who's not preaching the law as if it's still true after the gospel's been proclaimed.
Right.
Brian might be that guy, though. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm working on it. I'm trying to get there. I'm trying to increase in my antinomian sanctification.
I have a phrase that I tend to use. I don't know. Oh, by the way, I'm drinking a Woodford Reserve here, straight Kentucky bourbon. Good stuff.
Oh, look at that.
I'm going fancy, and I got the Glencairn glass to go with it. I don't know if I'm paraphrasing Luther. I got this from somewhere, but when I see my own fruit, I tend to eat it.
Yeah,
and that's kind of what I think with the sanctification thing. Well, where are your good works? It's like, look, if I'm missing my good works, I'm instantly going to turn around and be proud of them, and all of a sudden, it's about me and my pride, and you know me, and right. I've completely undone whatever good works there that may have been done because I've turned around and looked at them and said, oh, check it out. I got a good work there. Look at that. Go me. You know, pat myself on the back.
And we had that conversation earlier about distinguishing between dogmatics and systematics, and some of this, for me, the frustration is that we've dogmatized the meaning of the word sanctification to mean something that I don't think is its primary meaning in the Bible. In the Bible, sanctification is holiness, proximity to God. It is not righteousness. Righteousness is its own thing. It's a different thing. There's a relationship between the two. That's why I like the Augsburg Confession. It doesn't have an article on sanctification. It has an article on the new obedience, because it puts it in a better category, I think. And then there was a book by Preuss, not J.O., what was his son's name? Was he another Jack? Jack the Third? Mm-hmm. Called Just Words.
Yeah.
And he talked about the metaphors of Scripture and how sanctification is one way of talking about the gospel, and justification is another way of talking about the gospel. And what I took from that is that this solves our James 2 problem too. There are two kinds of justification, and the Christian who has been justified by grace does strive to justify himself by works before his neighbor. Not before God, but before his neighbor. There's nothing wrong with talking in those terms. James does it, right? We got to throw James out otherwise. Thanks for the book, Peter.
I was glad that Peter had to go to get the book because it proved that he was wearing pants.
Oh, wait, what just happened? So there is a place for talking about the justice of the new man, that the new man strives for this justice. And there's a place for talking about that he is, in God's sight, truly in close proximity to God, particularly when he's taking the Lord's Supper. You know, Jesus is actually in us with his holiness. But when we let these things encroach on the law-gospel dynamic and try to pit them against each other so that I can look at the law again after I've had the gospel and have my security rest on the law, that's the threat. That's the danger to the conscience that destroys faith. Yeah?
That's pietism. Right there. Yep.
But you said there's good things about it, though. Tell me the good things.
Yeah, I remember.
Just not that one.
I broke my leg earlier.
The solution is bad. Yep.
Yeah.
There's a we talk about the problem is that not enough people talk about the third use of the law, but I really think we need to recover the first use of the law and understand how God is in the commandments shapes the ordering of the world.
Yes.
That's been completely lost. Like the Psalm says, when the foundations are destroyed, what will the righteous do? And this idea that we live in an orderly world is just about gone. And then when it comes around to the Christian, we realize that there are some things that the Christian can do that the unbeliever can't. For example, pray. The
right.
Christian can pray. The Christian can believe that God will support us in our death. The Christian believes that that God created us and sustained us and will raise us from the dead and lives accordingly. So that there is a different there's works that the law requires that are opened up to us apart from faith. Suffering and patience and things like that.
Not apart from faith, but in faith, right? I think you misspoke. You didn't mean apart from faith, though. First three commandments,
right.
I only keep them by faith.
No, that's exactly.
Only the Christian can do that. And even that, then, I must recognize as imputed to me. So that when I have prayed to God, I can't pat myself on the back and say, well, I'm more holy than I was yesterday. No.
Well, that's right. Always the Lord is teaching us to pray to have mercy and to forgive our sins. So even
right.
in our prayers, we're realizing how profoundly deep the corruption of sin goes.
At what point do I stop praying, lead me not into temptation?
Yeah. Right? At the end of the day, we are all unworthy servants.
And then, so Peter, you said there's a question in the comments then connected to this?
Game of Thrones. So on the last Hanging Out, the topic of Game of Thrones came up and was brushed aside. However, I'm seriously wondering your thoughts on it, and I'm going to expand this to entertainment in general, not just Game of Thrones, because that's fairly specific. Is the TV show or / books okay for Christians to expose themselves to?
That's a great question. And I'm going to jump in because
kind of content.
He's equipped to handle this at all, because he doesn't read at all.
Just go draw something, Brian. Just doodle in the background.
I'll
while
draw the, my the, rendition of Game of Thrones.
Go have fun with that. Your expansion, Peter, to entertainment in general is where we actually got to start, because the danger is that once you start drawing hard and fast black and white lines that are not the Ten Commandments around what you watch for entertainment, you can't stop with Game of Thrones. Can a Christian watch a TV show in which somebody lied? Can I watch it? They lied to each other. The characters lied. Is it okay? I exposed myself to sin. And most people are going to say, yeah, that's fine. Okay, well, so then why are you now going to draw the line about a sword in a war being used? Or about adultery between two people who are clearly evil people? Where are you going to draw this line for all Christians at all times to no longer be exposed to seeing sin? And at what point, then, do you no longer read the Bible because you can't read the Old Testament stories and their wickedness? That's pretty good, Ryan. You know more than you let on. So, Game of Thrones has problems. I'm not going to try to whitewash that. And I think the bigger problem is not HBO's nudity and adultery. I'm still the for Brian and Dr. Rast, if you don't know, the books aren't done yet. There's two more books that are supposed to come out. My fear for this book is its fatalistic, nihilistic lack of a hero. He has killed the good over and over and over again. It's depressing to read. And the worldview that expresses, if there is no redemption, if there is no virtue at the end of this story, I don't want to read it again, ever. Yeah. Aside from the sin of the bad people that I see, which as a Christian I can know that's wrong, and is there a point at which the HBO show, I'd rather not watch that part? Yeah, sure. But why are we always so afraid, and Game of Thrones is a great example, why are we so afraid of watching sexual sin for a moment? We're not afraid of false theology. Yeah. We're not afraid of worldviews that destroy our faith. Those things, we'll watch the Super Bowl halftime show and not bat an eye at how pagan that was.
Yeah.
So that's, if we're going to have that question and draw lines for all Christians, we just got to turn the TV off. Or we've got to catechize you so you can learn to discern what you're watching. Mm-hmm. And I think that's my answer. It's what I do, is what I want to teach my kids to do. So I think turning the TV off is not realistic.
And I think to kind of add to that, not that this is the final answer, but be a, there's a self-awareness that we need to have as well, that I am drawing not necessarily arbitrary lines, but I am picking and choosing. Kind of like what you said about the Super Bowl, you know, we'll watch the Super Bowl halftime but not the other one. I think that's something we need to emphasize over and over and over again, that is, if you're going to draw lines about you can watch this but not this, you are, in a sense, drawing arbitrary lines, because I can always find something where you have not been consistent with your own new rules that you've created for yourself and are attempting to impose on others. And so we need to be very careful. And this is where we come into that pietism and the legalism and the influence there.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Brian, you want to jump in? Dr. Rast, you want to jump in? Either one.
I think I was talking to my good friend Pastor Jared Melius about this the other day, and we were talking about the difference between depictions of Fifth Commandment sins and Sixth Commandment sins in movie and things like this. And one of the things that he pointed out to me, which I think is helpful, and I'm still working through this, is that, you know, if my kids are in a movie and they're acting out some sort of murder, I know that that's acting and that everyone is, in fact, still involved. There wasn't actual murder involved, even though it was depicted. The same thing is not true with Sixth Commandment sins, especially when it becomes there's nudity or pornography involved. It's not only a depiction of a sin, it is a sin in itself. So there's a way that according to the Sixth Commandment, our conscience is particularly sensitive, and I think we need to be particularly aware of that.
I think that's really good in the sensitivity. I think you're really onto something there, that we are sensitive to it. And please don't hear anything I said earlier about a blanket, yeah, go ahead and watch nudity, it's fine. No. And goodness, I wish that good story was being told without having to do that. Why does the HBO have to show that? But I'll go one better on you there, Brian, because here's the trick. You went 5 to 6. Let's go to 8.
Yeah.
Because the entire movie's a lie.
Yep.
The whole thing, start to finish. The early Christians, actors couldn't be Christians because they're lying for a living, right? Yep. Are we ready to say that? And if we're ready to say that and the whole church wants to say that and we're going to turn the TV off together cumulatively, I'm on board. I'll go with you. But as long as we're going to try to draw these lines arbitrarily and not go all the way, I question the hypocrisy of it. But I don't want to dismiss what you were saying about the conscience. And if your conscience is being bound by what you're watching, turn it off. Turn it off. If you can't avert your eyes, if it's inflaming your lust, turn it off. But don't assume that everyone's conscience is right where yours is, or that everyone's tempted by the same things that you are. There are individuals that aren't, you know. What was the one you said you've never been tempted by, Brian? Oh, earlier. I mean, just think about this, the cutting. right? The self-mutilation. There's a temptation there I've not known. Thank God, right? Dr. Rast, I don't know if you want to go out on a limb on this one. This is sort of a risky conversation.
Well, you went where I wanted to go, Jonathan, actually, with the whole point about acting in general. I mean, there have been numerous times in the history of the church where we said, you just can't do it. So take, for example, one of the greatest preachers in the history of the church, George Whitfield, not greatest theologians, but greatest preachers, who desperately wanted to be an actor, but his family said, this is sinful, fundamentally sinful, you can't do it. So he became a preacher. There you go.
In the early life of the Missouri Synod, couldn't go to the movies, right?
Couldn't go to the movies, couldn't play cards.
Life insurance, yep.
Yeah, life insurance, usury, no investment with a credit card or car loans.
But the movies, what we're talking about, the movies. You couldn't, and there was, what I'd like to read is their conversation. Dr. Rast, I'm sure you've seen this, what they were talking about, why they understood the, they knew something, which maybe we've forgotten, and that is that this shaping of our conscience and the shaping of our practical philosophy, even the shaping of our theology, happens when we engage in entertainment.
And I think we still have a sensitivity to it when it comes to the theater, to acting and the like. Where we don't have it at all is in respect to sports. You know, right. Just
that's a sacred cow. Are you sure you want to go there?
You can't touch it. You just can't touch it. There's right. No way.
And that is the thing that on Sunday for the kids is more important than church.
Yeah,
things right. That keep a family away from church, but sports will do it.
Yeah, they'll do it.
They won't go out to a movie on Sunday morning, right? But they'll go to the sporting event.
Yeah,
that's fair. I've struggled with this even as a writer. You know, can you write a fiction? Brian, you make fun of it. Can I write a fiction novel? Am I lying? Was C.S. Lewis doing harm to the world when he wrote his fairy story about the lion that saved Lucy?
Well, Tolkien would say yes.
Oh, that, yeah, right. Just as a personal attack. And I guess I'm just not there. I think being aware of the conscience is pretty key.
Mm-hmm.
I think the early Missouri Synod, they may have been able to see what we can't see now because we're immersed in it, was the power of mixed medium.
Right.
And what mixed medium can do to the mind, turning the mind off.
Right.
Again, my answer to this is not necessarily turn off. It's be catechized so you know how to discern. If we can't discern, it doesn't do us any good. You can do all the – close all the windows and dot all the I's and T's. And if you can't discern
– right. If you approach it legalistically and say, you can do this, but you can't do this,
right.
It's never going to happen.
Right.
If people are not equipped to discern, then you've already lost the game.
And right. We've seen that. I think we see this coming home to roost now with all the Christian movies that are being made, and Christians are eating them up and loving it and not even seeing the problems, whether it's the War Room. Fisk, you had some brief comments about Risen. I know nothing about that one, but I mean, any number of those Christian movies that are out there where it's like, this is just chock full of bad theology, and we're totally missing it.
I'll be talking about Risen tomorrow on Issues Etc. when we talk about feminist culture. There's a lot of things that could be said about Risen, but I was disturbed greatly that the movie is pretty good until Jesus shows up. And then suddenly you have a bunch of giggling feminist communists hugging each other and laughing and being unreasonable as their answer to all criticism from the skeptics. And it was just weird. I don't know. I got to be more fluent on Issues, et cetera, tomorrow than I am right now. But it was.
Yeah, I always say my good stuff for Issues too.
Yeah,
yeah. Certainly not on Table Talk Radio. We all know that.
It was disturbing to me how I could walk out of that theater with three other Lutheran men from my congregation who wanted to go to it, and I broached the topic so that they wouldn't have to. But I knew every single one of them walked out of there embarrassed to be a Christian. Because they wouldn't follow that group of people, ever.
Right.
And that's what we're selling. That's the best we can give, is that Jesus kind of makes you happy, and don't ask questions about it. He's everywhere. Oh, it's just a disaster.
Jesus told the parables, and if you wanted to say it, you could say, look, those weren't true. There wasn't actually a sower who went out to sow seed, you know. There wasn't actually a strong man who was bad.
Met Bronze Age modernists who say that they were true stories to get around just this very point, that they all really happened.
This is... That's kind of goofy.
It is.
The whole point. You sit there, and when you're reading C.S. Lewis, you know that what he's telling you is a story. You know, yeah. You know when you go to the movies that there's a story. You know when you sit down to play poker that you're going to be sitting there telling stories with your face and your bets and stuff like this. Everybody knows it, so there's a context that's important to consider in this thing. So.
But when you watch a man kissing a woman and they're not married, they have to be doing something inappropriate. Even to film it. And that is a distinctly different reality. I get it, but I'm still not sure that makes it therefore okay for me to watch a man pretend to stab another man through the gut so that his bowels spill out across the screen. Even though I know it's fake, the image of God was just desecrated before my eyes.
Yeah, no, for sure. So seeing the depiction of these things also has an effect on the conscience. Yeah. But So and that's important for us to know too, especially for all you crazy video game players.
Yeah,
right. Video games are not the issue. Movies are.
Wait a minute.
I think Dr. Rast put his finger on it better. More as you do that, put his thumb on it. I mean, so here we are, all worried about our kids playing a video game in which they're chopping up a Lego world. Made up of pretend blocks and rebuilding little castles and fighting zombies in it, and we're not afraid of the sports. And we're not afraid of the progressive educational theory the NEA has pushed on all of our schools, including our Lutheran schools. We're going to send them off to college so they can be rich, because that's what Jesus said, is be rich before you die. Right?
It's in the back somewhere. You can find it. Just go look it up.
And then we want to blame this whole thing on Little Big Planet, I mean, which is a video game with a sack person that jumps over stuff. Yeah. You know?
Right.
I don't know.
No.
So, Brian, you're the pietist. That's case closed.
Case closed. Hopefully next time we do this, I'll be able to be the mystic.
For the viewer, it's a great question. It's a great question, and the reason it's great is because there's no single answer. Other than we have the Ten Commandments, the Creed, and the Lord's Prayer, and you've got to discern what you are comfortable with observing in that context and what does not bind your context nor lead you into temptation. And if it's doing that, you got to draw those lines around you. But you want to be careful not to force another to do something just because you do it. An alcoholic who gives up alcohol needs to give up alcohol, but not all people need to give up alcohol as a result of that. And in terms of praying for an age where our media would be a little less godless, well, that'd be great. Not sure if it's coming.
Not coming.
No.
Not coming.
No, it's going the other way.
We haven't touched on how you have conversations with the pagans and you can make connections. It's weird. The media generation is more, like, I can meet someone on the street who I don't know. And if we both watch the same miniseries or series, you know, seven seasons of a show, and we start talking about it, it's like we're buddies. It's like we've known each other all our lives. So there is something about communication in this age that we can't go out of the world. And that's the other half of this. So how do you stay in this world, not be of it? There is no strict answer to that other than word and sacrament. Brian figured it out, but other than that.
No, I did figure it out. But I know, I mean, one of the problems we face is that in the scriptures, you have there's pictures that you can that the Bible, the prophets, and the apostles will use to communicate, and they're basically two kinds of pictures. They're the picture of life on the farm, and they're the picture of life in the temple, and so there was a common life which brought forth a common picture. For which we can communicate and tell stories. So you know, I mean, the only reason I know that a lamb is silent before its shearers is because Jesus didn't say anything to Pilate. Now, that's going the opposite way. I'm supposed to hear in that verse, I'm supposed to know how lambs are when they're getting sheared and then just be able to compare it to Jesus. But we, with this kind of fracturing of life in modernity and the separation that we have and having no common life, that really the only place that we can go to have that is in our pop culture, songs and media.
It is. This is where Lewis was particularly helpful, and Tolkien right there with him, though, in recognizing, and they saw this before it had gotten as far as it had, but they had their finger on this one, was that of all the stories being told everywhere, the ones that are worth watching, that anybody will watch, they have to steal from the real story. They can't not. If they don't, it becomes not worthwhile. This is my point about the Game of Thrones. If there's no redemptive story, no one's going to read it again once it's over. If all the good characters just die, it'll be the phenomenal thing that it was, and it'll be gone. For it to be real, you have to borrow from the real hero story. And in that, then, those are those moments that we can touch on in the lives of postmodern people and say, we got the real one. We got the actual gold. You know, Captain America, he's awesome. But Jesus died on the cross to actually stop Hydra.
Yeah.
What time is it?
Wait a minute.
Jesus, no, I can't believe that just happened.
But it's true. It's true. And even, I'll even give you this. Why is Hydra, I mean, I'm reaching here, but Hydra is a snake. They crush the head of the serpent. They have to borrow. They have to borrow from our story. We have the real one. And earphones coming back. This is where we got to end, but the dogma thing too, there's a point at which you can dogmatize what we believe so far that you lose the story. And I wonder a lot of times with our young people, I'm talking my confirmands, is the reason that they are struggling to comprehend what was taught because we've turned it all into a bunch of scientific knowledge and they're not in the story anymore. Mm-hmm. They're not in the history. David was not their king. They're not waiting for his throne to be sat upon again. How do we get that back? Kings and Games of Thrones and things like that, Brian. So, hey, Dr. Rast, thank you for being our guest this evening. I hope we haven't been too annoying to you.
No, no. We do this every night, Dr. Rast, so we'll see you tomorrow, 9:30.
He's a lying liar.
I was acting.
Hey, before we go, Dr. Rast, if somebody was interested in pursuing a seminary education in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, how would they go about getting in touch with your great organization?
Our great organization, our website is www.ctsfw, Concordia Theological Seminary, Fort Wayne, .edu. And we got all kinds of great stuff there. Come see us.
Excellent. Brian, I'd say thank you, but I'm not sure it would be honest.
I'd say you're welcome.
I have a problem with this picture back there. It's still bothering me. Hey, is the Enterprise the force, being sucked Harry. In by a tractor beam? Is the Death Star shooting the Enterprise? Like, what's going on there?
I'll explain it to you later in Klingon.
You viewers, thanks for tuning in. Those of you who have been with us the whole time or just came in the middle, we're glad you're here. Look for some daily fixes and grappling coming out this week as well. Remember, if you are not yet a member of the Lutheran Ninja Clan, that Worldview Everlasting is viewer-supported, and $5 a month goes a long way toward making all our tech and everything else keep going the way it is. We've got bigger plans for the future as well. You can find more information about that on our website, worldvieweverlasting.com, which hopefully we'll have some new stuff there as well. Peter's working on the Catechism for the Evangelical Influence. Is that front on the front and center, Peter, or not?
It's a page I can send the link. We don't have a link to it on the homepage, but if you're in the WEtv dojo, WEtv Inside the Dojo, search for that on Facebook. I'll post the link there, and you can find it and download it and become a better Lutheran.
Yeah, make sure you put that in the comments for this, or in the information for this video as well.
Yeah, I'll put it in the description of the video here. That's a good idea.
It's a series of about 20 hours of media. If you're just experiencing Lutheranism for the first time, it'll walk you through all the most important stuff. And Peter did a lot of work putting that together as he was actually struggling with it himself, if I'm not mistaken.
As I'm walking through it, it's what helped me.
All right, so checking out. Thanks for tuning in. Everyone have a good night. Rock on.